is Leaving by J.B. Priestley, dramatised for radio by Elizabeth Bradbury, with Frederick Treves as Dr. Salt. Salt is Leaving.
All right, Miss Culworth. One moment and I'll take some particulars. Now, your father's full name?
Edward James Culworth.
And the address?
The bookshop, High Street, Hempton.
My sister works there.
And the last you saw him was yesterday lunchtime?
That's right. He took a telephone call in the office, then he went out. He looked very worried.
You don't know who the call was from?
No.
He went home, packed a small bag, took a few pounds.
And the last person to see him was this bus inspector at Hempton, who says he got onto the 140 bus to Birkden here.
Yes.
I see. Well, it could be anything, couldn't it? Gone to see relatives.
We've rung all our close relatives. He's not with any of them.
Well, Birkden's a big place. All sorts of things to do.
He's not like that.
Miss, it's only 24 hours. Isn't it a bit premature?
My feelings exactly, Sergeant, but...
Look, miss, all we can do is put out a general call with a description. And I'd rather do that tomorrow than today.
You think we're making a fuss about nothing?
Well, in the circumstances, your father being the sort of man you say he is, I don't think we come into the picture yet.
But why didn't he tell us anything?
Miss Culworth, if he doesn't choose to tell you everything he does, that's his right. Not a police matter. Unless you've not told me everything.
We've told you all we know. And I'm not making a fuss. I know what sort of a man he is. I've got his shop on my hands. If he doesn't come back soon, I don't know what the hell to do.
Oh, come on now, Maggie, please. Please, don't. Just calm down.
That's it, Mr. Culver.
Oh, leave me alone. Oh, I'm sorry.
Well, then, steady. You all right?
Oh, yes.
I'll take care of her, thank you. She's upset.
So I see. What was all that about, Sergeant Broadbent?
Oh, hello, Dr. Salt. Oh, middle-aged man gone missing. Bookseller from Hempton, name of Culworth.
Oh.
You know the sort of thing. He'll turn up again when he's had enough of the bright lights. I didn't expect to see you, Doctor. I thought you'd left us.
Oh, not yet. I'm going very soon. I've already handed over my practice to Dr. Baldwin. He's a pleasant young fellow. Your wife will like him.
Oh,
but before I go, I want to talk to somebody about another missing person, a former patient of mine, young girl.
Important, is it, Dr. Zolt?
Well, I wouldn't be here if it wasn't. And I don't want one of your ordinary CID chaps. I want to go as high as possible, please.
I know you well enough, Dr. Salt. I'll try and get Superintendent Hurst to see you. But you better make it sound important.
Well, don't worry, I shan't need to pile it on. I suspect everything's been piled on already.
Dr. Salt, I think I've seen you in court, haven't I? Giving evidence, I mean, not in the dock. Do sit down.
Oh, thank you.
And you can tell me what we can do for you, if it's our business.
It's not yours, Superintendent. It's somebody's. I've disposed of my practice here and I'm leaving Birkden. I want to leave everything nice and tidy, but it's not.
No?
A patient of mine is missing, a young girl called Noreen Wilkes.
Noreen Wilkes? Can't say I know the name. Give me some particulars.
Age 19. Mother died a few years ago, sarcoma. Never mentioned her father. He probably cleared out and left them. Anyway, her mother died, she left home and lodged with a Mrs. Pearson. She's friendly with the daughter, an usherette at the Lyceum.
I see. What's the address?
45 Olton Street.
Yeah, that rings a bell. Hold on. Sergeant?
Yes, sir?
Mrs. Pearson, 45 Olton Street. Haven't we had her in here?
She's been in a couple of times, sir. Half cut she was.
Ah, that's it, Sergeant. I've got it now. Not much wrong with my memory, Doctor. What sort of a girl would you say this Noreen Wilkes is?
Oh, what you'd expect from a bad background. Not vivacious, no real harm in her, but empty-headed, floppy, silly.
Ah, just another of these little fly-by-nights. We've had scores of them through here. It's all gin and impulsiveness and sex with them. Don't you waste your time asking about this Noreen Wilkes. She might have gone to Birmingham, London, anywhere. Now, if you'll excuse me, Doctor, I've got things to see to.
Sit down, Superintendent, and don't give me any more of that.
Now, look, Doctor.
I know just what goes on in Birkden. I ought to, after 7 years of it. Now, listen. Noreen Wilkes seems to have been missing for about 3 weeks. She's suffering from a very unusual form of chronic nephritis.
Oh? What's that?
A kidney disease. If you want the medical details, you can have them. It's rather a speciality of mine, if an overworked GP can have a speciality.
I'll take your word for all that, Dr. Salt. But where's the urgency?
Well, I'd worked out a treatment for her. It just kept her going nicely. And I'd impress it upon her if she went without treatment for several weeks. She'd soon be very ill indeed and might die. She knew this was serious, and she was frightened. And she gave me a solemn promise. She carried in her bag a note from me to any doctor she might report to, giving details of the treatment and asking him to get in touch with me.
Mm. And you've heard nothing?
No doctor, in or out of a hospital, has been in touch with me about her.
But in spite of her solemn promise, she may not have seen a doctor, just not bothered.
And by now she'd be in hospital or dead.
Good morning, Superintendent.
Ah, Sir Arnold.
I've just been having a word or two with the chief constable.
This is Dr. Salt, Sir Arnold Donnington. Dr. Salt's worried about a patient of his, a girl called Noreen Wilkes, who seems to have disappeared. But I'm sure he won't mind if we...
Dr. Salt? We've met before, I think.
Hmm?
In court, when I was on the bench. You gave some rather controversial evidence on behalf of that fellow Edwards.
Oh, yes, he was a sick man.
I seem to remember he was given a stiff sentence at the Assizes afterwards.
And he's still a sick man, probably worse.
Well, society has to be protected.
Some of it's not worth protecting.
No doubt some of it isn't. You should try being an industrialist these days, Dr. Salt. We have to employ about 1,500 women and girls. They come and go as they please, say and do what they like, swear like troopers, or pack up and go if a foreman criticizes their work. No idea of order, responsibility, of trying to earn the wages we have to pay them. Perhaps the young woman you're inquiring about...
Noreen Wilkes.
Perhaps she was one of them.
Yes, she did work at United Fabrics for a time, I believe, Sir Arnold. Oh, please, do talk to the superintendent. I can wait.
I shan't be long, and you needn't go. Nothing private about this. It's the old Worsley place, Hurst. You're keeping an eye on it for us.
Nothing's happened up there, has it, sir?
Not to my knowledge, as I haven't been near the place for months. You know we bought it so we could turn it into an annex to the Fabrics Club. Well, the contractors are making a start very soon now. But over these last few days, I'd like your fellows to keep a particularly sharp eye on the place.
Haven't you got your own man up there? What's his name? Corrigan?
That's the point, Hurst. He's not working at the moment. As soon as the contractors start, they'll put in their own night watchman. There's nothing inside worth stealing, but there's lead on the roof.
And that's what the villains like, Sir Arnold.
Well, we don't want to lose it now. So tell your fellows to chase anyone out of the grounds. A dog would be useful.
Well, I'm afraid we couldn't justify that, sir.
No. We people who keep the town going mustn't ask too much, must we? Oh, well, keep an eye on the place the next few days. That's all I ask.
We'll do that, Sir Arnold.
Excellent. Dr. Salt, I hope you find your patient, Dora Jilks.
Noreen Wilkes.
Good day to you both.
Good day, sir.
The Mr. Big of Birkden. Chairman, United Anglo-Belgian Fabrics. Chairman, Birkden Telegraph Publishing Company. Senior Magistrate, other things too. Oh, Mr. Very Big of Birkden.
Sir Arnold can be stiff and sharp, but he's a fine man. I don't know anybody who's done more to make Birkden what it is today.
No doubt, but what's that?
Well,
don't tell me I've spent too much time at the wrong end of it. Actually, Donnington didn't strike me as being stiff and sharp. In fact, he was extremely nervous.
Well, it's not a month since he lost his only son. The chief constable says it hit him very hard.
Ah, when a man's son commits suicide...
Dr. Salt, the verdict was accidental death, and it's not going to be anything else in this office. I know he was cleaning a gun at 5 a.m, but it's still accidental death here. Now, have you got anything more to say to me about this girl?
She hasn't reported for treatment anywhere. She isn't in any hospital. And if she left Birkden, nobody seems to know when or how, and nobody cares. Now, where is she? You could begin by making a few inquiries.
We'll do that, of course. And we can do it better than you, Dr. Salt. We don't encourage amateur investigations.
Oh, I've never fancied myself as a detective.
Oh, glad to hear you say that, sir. I just had a feeling you might.
I have a feeling, too. A gloomy hunch. I can't help believing that Noreen Wilkes never left Birkden. And if she didn't, I think she's dead.
Ticket, please.
Hello, Peggy Pearson.
Dr. Salt! Are you coming in? Everyone seems to like it this week.
I want to talk to you, Peggy.
Oh, it's awkward here.
I know, but it's important.
Oh, I'll bet it's about Noreen. Well, you stand by me while I take the tickets.
You were a friend of hers. She stayed at your house.
Oh, that was Mum. She wanted a lodger. Funny thing, we were great friends before, but then when she came to live with us, I hardly saw her. I was up when she was asleep, then she'd be out when I went to bed. She's not been working lately, been going to posh parties. Can I have your ticket, please?
Yeah.
Room up on the right.
Ciao.
She'd come here and talk sometimes, in the cafe.
When did you talk to her last? Try and remember.
Sometime in the second week of September.
The last time she came to my surgery was the morning of September the 12th.
That's it, Mum's birthday. That night she went out and never came back.
Oh.
It was the day before she'd come here for the last time. Very excited, she had to talk to somebody. If you want to know where she is, Dr. Salt, I think I can tell you.
Go on, Peggy.
Well, she told me one of these posh party boys from the Fabrics Club she'd been around with was taking her to the south of France.
Mm-hmm.
After that, she thought he'd marry her. Mad about her, she said he was. Wouldn't tell me his name. I'm not part of all that. But if you want to know where she is, I think she's in the south of France on a beach drinking martinis.
Oh, no, Peggy, she isn't.
How do you know that?
She hadn't a passport.
I signed her application form for one on the morning of the 12th.
Oh, I expect she went to London with this chap and got it there.
She could have, Peggy, but I don't think she did. Fabrics Club, is that where she used to go with her boyfriend?
I think so, but they went somewhere else as well. She was sleeping with him, I know that much. And I'll tell you something else, Doctor.
Mm-hmm.
She always said these party boys would never see 50 again, dirty old men. But this one was young, not much older than her. Money there too, she said. But that's Noreen. Not much sense, but lucky. Lucky all the while.
I don't think so, Peggy. Only part of the way. Is there anything else you can tell me?
No. Nothing that has anything to do with this, anyway.
You're quite sure, Peggy?
Yes, quite sure.
Well, thank you, Peggy. I'm going to have a talk with your mother.
South of France, that's where she'll be. Can I have your tickets? There's four down on the front on the left.
It's all questions, isn't it? I had one of them plainclothes sergeants here this afternoon, taking an interest. About time.
Well, I think you can say I started that, Mrs. Pearson. What did you tell him?
What I told them before. They weren't interested then. Well, I admit, when I went to the station, I'd had a drink or two. No, I told this sergeant she'd gone out that evening, the 12th. I remember because it was my birthday. Oh, she was looking very smart. I'll say that for
you. Yes, but you expected her back.
Well, of course. She wouldn't have left Birkden without coming back for some of her things. Not even if he was going to buy her some clothes, whoever he was. I don't care what a girl is and what she's up to. She doesn't walk out and leave everything. Well, this, for instance.
Hmm? A teddy bear?
Noreen told me she'd had it ever since she was two. She'd never stir without it. Oh, Doctor, what's happened to her? I know Peggy thinks she's in France with her chap, but I don't. I just don't. 3 weeks and never a word. Where is she?
I don't know, Mrs. Pearson, but I'm going to find out. And I'm not leaving Birkden until I do.
Dr. Salt, eh?
What? Good. How did you get in?
Walked in.
Well, this isn't a surgery, and I'm not in practice now.
And I ain't ill.
Well, don't wear those damn silly dark glasses too often, or you'll ruin your eyesight. Good afternoon.
Hey, I want to talk to you. You're leaving Birkden, ain't you?
Soon. Why?
I've a friend who wants his flat right sharp.
Go away.
Look, 100 quid there, nice fivers, no tax, lovely money. Your friend says it's all yours if you walk out tonight.
All right, it's a bargain. I'll leave here tonight, and your friend books me a suite for a few days at the Queen's Hotel.
Oh, no, that's out.
I thought so. Now put your money away.
You think you're being clever, Dr. Salt, but you're not. You're being stupid. If you're leaving Birkden, you can't like it much.
No.
I like it, but I'll go with the right kind of people. You don't. You're stupid.
You've made your point.
No, just coming to it. Look, if I want you out of Birkden, it's only for your own good. You're not popular. You've been careless. You've made enemies. And you're not working here anymore. You're not important to anybody. You're a redundant man. It can be a nasty experience.
Oh, yes. What are you proposing to do?
Nothing. I'm just warning you. After that, I mind my own business and you'll mind yours.
I am doing.
Look, clear out now and you can take this 100 quid with you. I'll see that everything's properly packed and put in store. There's a good train to the smoke at 6:30 and 6 to Birmingham. That's if you like Birmingham.
I don't, and I don't like you. So, go away.
Hello, Alan Culworth.
I'm sorry to disturb you, Alan. Were you teaching?
No, it's all right. What's up, Maggie?
There's a letter in today's post for Father. The address is just Mr. Culworth, Bookshop, Hempton.
Huh.
And it's got Lyceum Cinema, Birkden on the envelope.
Well, have you opened it?
Yes, I'll read it to you. Dear Mr. Culworth, Dr. Salt came here to ask me about Noreen. And from what he said, I think I was wrong when I told you about her. And now there is trouble, so look out. But I'm in a hurry to write this, so can't explain. Yours truly, Peggy Pearson.
Who's Peggy Pearson?
I don't know, but it mentions trouble, Alan. Father's obviously involved in some way.
Yeah, well, it must have been written by someone who works at the Lyceum. I can't imagine Dad knowing anyone, though.
Look, he must have gone to Birkden and talked to this Peggy about the girl called Noreen, and it must have been on Monday.
Have you called the police?
No. Alan, I think we ought to go to Birkden and find out who these people are.
Well, I can't. I'm teaching all afternoon. Look, go to the police, Maggie.
No. I'm going to find out for myself.
Don't be daft. Birkden isn't Hempton. It's a big city.
I'm the girl who used to work in London, remember? I'll manage, Alan.
Peggy Pearson? Yes, she's one of our usherettes.
I'd like to speak to her.
So would I. But I'm afraid you can't. She's not here.
Where is she?
I don't know. But we did have a bit of trouble yesterday. Hmm? I don't want it to go any further, but some tough knocked her down. She was very shaken.
Why? How did it happen?
Oh, I don't know. I expect he was trying to get in without a ticket. A lot of yobs in Birkden these days, and we get them.
It wasn't someone she knew?
Well, she wouldn't say much about him. I wanted to call the police, but she wouldn't hear of it. Got quite hysterical. I sent her home by taxi, but I've not heard a word since.
I'm sorry, dear. She's not here. While I was out last night, her ladyship comes back from work, packs her suitcase, and leaves a note to say she's gone to Birmingham. I know no more than that. You say your father's missing?
Yes, that's why I need to find her, Mrs. Pearson.
Oh, well, I don't think she'd be with him. A man old enough to be her father.
No, no, I didn't mean that I thought...
No, I think she went to get away from some trouble.
Does the name Noreen mean anything to you?
Yeah. You don't know?
Of course I don't know. I just know that if I can't find Peggy, I ought to talk to Noreen.
You can't. She's been missing for the last 3 weeks.
Oh, no, are you sure?
Of course I am. She had a room here. She walked out one night and never came back. Dr. Salt knows all about it. He was Noreen's doctor. Ours as well.
Then I'll go and see Dr. Salt. Then if somebody tells me he's missing, I'll start screaming. I really am sorry to bother you, Dr. Salt, but I tried to find Peggy Pearson. She wasn't at the Lyceum. Apparently she rushed off to Birmingham last night.
Away from the trouble she mentions in this letter.
Does any of this make any sense to you?
Yes, most of it.
Thank goodness.
I can't tell you how your father comes to be involved, but you realise the central figure here is Noreen Wilkes.
She isn't to me. I only care about my father. Well, that's natural, isn't it?
Oh, certainly. But it may not be good enough. It's possible you may have to take an interest in Noreen Wilkes.
You think my father came to Birkden to ask about her?
Oh, we know he did. I seem to be missing. We might say Peggy Pearson is missing, too. And Noreen has been missing for the last 3 weeks. Too many people missing, don't you think, Miss Culworth?
I do. And you better call me Maggie.
Oh, certainly. Maggie.
Now, could you explain about this Noreen Wilkes?
Oh, surely. But first, can you drink China tea without milk and sugar? I've only just made it.
I'd love some.
You are.
What a beautiful bowl. Chinese too, isn't it?
Yes, I worked in the East until about 7 years ago. Went to Hong Kong right after I graduated. Then North Borneo, Penang, and Singapore.
Oh.
Let me move a few more books so that you can put it down.
This must have been a charming room before you began pulling yourself out of it. Can't help feeling that a woman must have had a hand in it originally.
My wife. She died 3 years ago, leukemia.
I'm sorry.
Would you like Birkden, Maggie?
Oh, I hardly know it. But I don't find it interesting. I spent 5 years in London, then I came back to Hempton.
Still small and attractive in spots.
That's just it. I can take Hempton, I can take London, but not a town like this. Too big and yet not big enough. Well, I imagine you don't care for it much. You're leaving.
Well, I was all right when there were Treves, but now... Well, I've got rid of my practice and I'd like to get out as soon as I can. But I'm not going until I know what happened to Noreen Wilkes.
Was she somebody rather special for you, Dr. Salt?
Not a person, no, not at all. But she was important to me as a patient because she was suffering from a type of kidney disease I'm particularly interested in. I had hit on a treatment that was keeping her going nicely. If she missed it for a couple of weeks, she soon ran into a screaming hypertension, and after that, she'd be fighting for her life. And she's been missing now for 3 weeks.
I see. So what do you think?
Well, I could be wrong, but I think she's dead. Have some more tea, Maggie.
Thank you.
Who do you have with you at home?
My mother. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to tell her any of this. My brother, Alan.
several years older than me, not married, and lectures in physics at the university.
Clever?
Very clever in some ways. Idiotic in others. But I'll tell him everything. He might be a great help.
Would you like to leave it to him?
No.
Look, Maggie, you still have a choice. Either go home now and try to forget about Noreen Wilkes and me, or help him to find out what happened to her in the hope you might discover where your father is. I could do with some help.
Then that's settled.
Not quite. We may have to take the lid off, Birkden. What we find inside might not be pleasant. Might even be dangerous.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes, really. I've got to go and see a man. If you're going to help, you might learn something by coming with me.
Hello, Buzzy. Let me introduce Miss Maggie Culworth, Mr. Buzzy Duffy.
Oh, pleased to meet you, Miss Culworth. It's a great pleasure. It's a privilege. Now, Doctor, it's a treat to see you. It's lovely, it's lovely. Now, let me get you a drink, Miss Culworth.
Thank you. Gin and tonic, please.
A little whiskey for you, Doc.
Yes, please.
Now, it's 5-1. He's never told you what he'd done for my brother, Miss Culworth. Saved him when he was at death's door. You know, Dr. Salt here could make rings round the lot if he wanted to.
I'm sure he could, Mr. Duffy. I'll
call him Buzzy.
Oh, you do that, Miss Culworth. Now, they tell me you're packing it in, Doc. A lot of people are going to be sorry.
Oh, a few, only a few, Buzzy.
Yeah, you're dead right, of course. Most of them wouldn't notice if a wooden dummy was taking their temperatures. They're only wooden dummies themselves. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. Buzzy, why do you have this window thing here along your office wall?
Oh, that's so I can see what's happening in the club. The dance floor's down there, you see. Oh. Any trouble, I can spot it. All right, Winston boy, what do you want?
It's Charlie, Mr. Duffield, on the blower from Northampton. Do you want to put him through?
No. What's he want?
He's got 85 transistors. They're jack jobs. He'll take 14 each, he says.
Not from we, he won't. Winston, boy, they must be hotter than a baker's flue. Tell Charlie not to be ruddy stupid.
Yes, Mr. Duffield.
Hey, what about that one, I ask you? Winston. Winston Sandby. Born in our finest hour. So now, Doc, what's worrying you? What is it, Miss Culworth?
Well, it may be both of us, Buddy. First of all, do you know an unpleasant young man with reddish hair, dark glasses and a leather jacket, who thinks he's an American gangster?
I do. RUSS. Come from Coventry, worked for me for a few weeks, but he got some wrong ideas. Proper villain. Been inside. Not giving you any trouble, is he, Doc?
Well, he might.
Well, now look. I've got some hard boys working for me that could tick him apart for a light workout. Oh, hark at me, Miss Culworth. You'd think it was Chicago or Detroit and young Winston out there was cleaning a Tommy gun. Me talking like that. Born and bred here in Birkden. Things have changed, all right. It was a decent little provincial town once.
So they tell me.
Wasn't so long ago, either. All of a sudden, though, we're big. We make shoes, we make hats, we make nylons. We've got United Anglo-Belgium Fabrics.
Stop there, please, Buzzy. At the fabrics. They run a club, don't they?
Oh, they do, Doc. Won't have me in, though. Too common. I know about it, though. Ask me. I'll tell you.
Hmm. Young girls from the town go there sometimes, don't they?
Oh, that's right. Party girls, these kids are. They feed them to the Belgian directors and the big buyers from the States and South America.
Buzzy, I met Sir Arnold Donnington yesterday morning.
Oh,
I didn't like him, but I can't see him attending these parties.
What, him? He wouldn't admit they existed. He fines school kids £2 for necking. Oh, he's a blue nose if there ever was one.
Yes, yet he's the big boss at United Fabrics.
Ah, but the old Dolce Vitti up there at the Fabrics Club is run by the sales director, Tommy Linsdale.
Oh, I see.
Likes the gay life, Tommy does. Oh, I know him. Used to bet with me now and then. Him and his fancy piece, they run the parties, you know. She finds the girls. He brought her here one night, slumming. A classy, handsome piece. And about as soft and tender as a sheet of high-duty alloy. Jill something her name was. Jill Frinton.
I know her. She comes in.
To the bookshop?
Yes, for novels in foreign languages.
Mm. For the buyers, I suppose.
My brother thinks she's fabulous.
But why the Fabrics Club, Doc? If you're thinking of living it up before you leave Birkden, you can have anything you want here. Buzzy's is all yours.
Oh, thanks, Buzzy, but I like a quiet life. Now, I'm asking questions because a young patient of mine is missing, Noreen Wilkes. She's not been heard of since September the 12th, and I think she went to a party at the Fabrics Club that night.
Noreen Wilkes?
Yeah.
I'll ask around. Some of my boys and girls might know something.
Thanks, Buzzy. Who do you think could be paying, Russ?
Anybody who wouldn't want him to sweat for his money. Otherwise, you've got me. But Winston will ask around.
It might get rough in a day or two.
If it does, Doc, let me know. If Ross or anybody promises you trouble, tell him from me to expect a punch-up. But it ain't likely, is it?
Just what I was going to ask.
Oh, it's extremely likely. Somebody wants me to clear out of Birkden. Somebody doesn't want any questions about Noreen Wilkes. I'm serious, Buzzy. I might have to ask you for a little protection.
Then you've got it, Doc. But watch it. Birkden isn't a very nice town anymore. What's your next move?
Oh, I thought we might pay a call at the Fabrics Club. Do you know who runs it?
Oh, I do. A right dance called Donald Dews. Mm-hmm. On the company pay sheet as assistant personnel officer. They get away with murder, these big combines. He looks and sounds like a powder puff twerp, but don't kid yourself. Don't kid yourself. He's as wired and crafty as they come. Now, I know, because a barman up there, Tony, used to work for me, and he's been back once or twice for a natter.
Anything else, Buzzy?
Oh, yes. Tony said there was a real hard case round there, a Yankee, on the admin side, but kept an eye on the club. Half a minute. Aricson, that's it.
Oh, thanks, Buzzy.
Well, Miss Culworth, pleased to have met you. Hope you find your father. You've got the right man to help you.
Dr. Saul, do you mind explaining exactly what connection you see between my father and this patient of yours?
Alan, there's no need.
Perhaps it's coincidence, but listen to this. Noreen Wilkes left her lodging on the evening of September the 12th, dressed for a party. She's not been heard of since. Early on the morning of the 13th, Derek Donnington, only son of Sir Arnold Donnington, head of United Anglo-Belgium Fabrics, shot himself. That might be a coincidence. It might be another coincidence when your father arrives on Monday, asks about Noreen and disappears.
Yes, but
it might be another that the cinema usherette he talked to cleared out in a panic last night. It might be another that a young man who tried to hustle me out of Birkden also visited the cinema. Well, I don't know what happens in physics, Culworth, but in medicine, we don't like as many coincidences as that.
No,
finally,
but
while I don't suppose anything serious has happened to your father, I think Noreen Wilkes is dead.
Isn't that going much too far?
Possibly. Perhaps Noreen and your father are laughing their heads off somewhere.
I'm sure that isn't true.
So am I. Ah, I'm going to ask a few questions at the Fabrics Club. You're welcome to come with me. We might all find something out.
What happens when we get there?
I do the talking.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. Quiet tonight?
Oh, it's early. Member?
My name's Salt, Dr. Salt.
Oh, yes.
Are you Tony?
No, Tony's left.
Oh, what a pity.
Most people don't think so. I took his place.
Oh, I don't really know Tony. He was mentioned to me by a friend.
Well, I can't serve you a drink unless you're a member.
Well, I don't want a drink.
Well, what do you want? Are these two with you?
Yes, they're friends of mine, Miss Culworth and Dr. Culworth from university. They're waiting for me. You see, I'd like to speak to the manager. Mr. Dews, isn't he?
Does he know you?
No, hardly anybody knows me.
I doubt if he'll see you.
Well, one of us could try, if he's here.
Oh, he's here. In his office.
Well, perhaps if I knocked and asked nicely, Mr. Dews would...
He wouldn't like it. Oh, you're lucky. He's just coming out. Mr. Dews?
Yes?
This is Dr. Salt. He'd like a word with you.
Well, if you want to see me, here I am. Shall we sit down, or do you prefer to stand? But why don't we have a drink?
Well, I'm not a member.
Well, we do have to be strict, but I do run the club, and now you're my guest.
Obviously, I'm not alone. This is Miss Maggie Culworth, and this is Dr. Alan Culworth of the University of Hemptonshire. They live in Hempton, and believe it or not, they're trying to find their father, Mr...
Edward Culworth.
Really? Ought they to? I mean, is there something wrong with him? Oh, look, do sit down. At least we can have a quick little drink. Miss Culworth?
Oh, gin and tonic, please.
Scotch and water.
Yeah. Same for me.
You heard that, George?
Yes, sir.
And the usual for me, Campari and vodka. Have you ever tried it?
I could never live up to it.
Now, you're being satirical, Dr. Salt. But don't you like our bar, Miss Culworth?
It's delightful.
We think so. And you should have seen it when I first took over 3 years ago. Like a miner's canteen. I nearly went out of my tiny mind. Oh, thank you, George. Well, cheers, dears.
Cheers.
Well, now, what can I do for you, Dr. Salt? Do you want to become a member? We do have two doctor members, but they're connected with the works.
Oh, who are they?
Dr. Bennett. You must know him.
Oh, yes, one of Birkden's bastions. And the other?
Dr. Lemmert. He's fairly new, quite young.
Yes, I've met him once or twice.
Well, now, I must tell you, and I know it's all very tedious and tiresome, that to join the club, you have to be proposed and seconded by two senior United Fabrics people. But then you must know some of them, Dr. Salt.
I'm afraid I don't. My practice was well below the executive level. However, I'm leaving Birkden.
Oh, lucky you. But how can I help you, then? There must be something.
Ah, there is, Mr. Dews. It's a little medical problem I ought to tackle before I leave Birkden. I'm trying to trace a patient of mine, a young girl called Noreen Wilkes, and I'm told she used to come here.
Yes, of course, I remember Noreen. Quite a pretty girl, though not very smart, not very bright. Rather common, really. But I haven't seen her for weeks.
Nobody seems to have seen her since September the 12th, Mr. Dews. But on that night, she came to a party here.
Did she? I can't remember. Oh, well, there's so much to-ing and fro-ing, as you can imagine. But we can soon find out.
Oh, how?
Everybody who isn't a member must be signed in. It's our strictest rule. And, of course, little Noreen isn't a member. So if she was here that night, she'll be in the book. George!
Sir?
Have you the book, or have I?
No, it's here. Coming over.
Ah, the sacred book. Now, what date did you say, Dr. Salt?
September the 12th.
September 12th. Here it is. And as you quite rightly said, we had one of our dreadful parties that night. Look, all those impossible names. Customers, of course. Well, now, well, I can't find a trace of little Noreen here. But do please check the list yourself.
Oh, thank you. No, Mr. Dews, her name's not here.
Definitely not, is it?
Mm.
I'm so sorry, Doctor. Evidently Noreen hadn't been invited that night. And you do understand, don't you, that I've nothing whatever to do with all that. I'm simply a kind of slave who has to make sure that the people who are invited are provided with sickening amounts of food and drink. But Noreen wasn't there. Perhaps she'd run off with somebody. She always seemed a rather flighty little thing. Oh, Jill! Jill, darling! You're the very person we want.
Just a minute, Donald. Do you have a telephone message for me, George?
Oh, yes, Miss Frinton. Mr. Linsdale's secretary rang you. She said Mr. Linsdale will be ringing you at home tonight from New York.
Thanks, George. Now, Donald, why am I the very person you want?
I'll explain in a moment, darling. But first, let me introduce Dr. Salt, Miss Jill Frinton.
How do you do?
Oh, I'm so sorry, Miss Culworth. This is Jill...
We've met someone before, haven't we?
Yes, in our bookshop in Hampton. Oh, this is my brother, Alan.
You wouldn't remember me.
Yes, I do.
You see, Jill, darling, Dr. Salt's been inquiring about your little Noreen Wills.
And not mine. I'm not having that.
Oh, do be cooperative, dear. We're all trying to do our best to help Dr. Salt, and she was one of your assorted bits and pieces. And Dr. Salt says she's been missing since September the 12th, one of our party nights. But she didn't attend our party that night because her name's not in the precious book.
Yes, Miss Frinton, a dead end there, I'm afraid.
I'm sorry.
Miss Frinton, I wonder if you'd be kind enough to allow us to call on you later this evening, say about 9 o'clock. I promise not to take up too much of your time. It'd be a great favour.
If you think I can be of help, Dr. Salt, why, of course. I live at 6 Cadogan Mansions, on the Hempton Road. 9 o'clock, then.
Thank you very much. And thanks for the drink and your help, Mr. Dews. This flat. You have excellent taste, Miss Frinton.
Thank you. Look, do sit down, everybody. Miss Culworth, a drink?
Do you mind if I don't? I've had so much tonight and I'm not used to it.
I wish I weren't. Well, you men, whiskey?
Let me help you.
You're very kind, Miss Frinton. I'm so glad of the chance to talk.
I'd better warn you, though, you won't learn any more from me than you did from Donald Dews and George.
Oh, that's all right. I didn't do too badly out of them.
You surprise me.
Oh, when you've practiced medicine as long as I have, you learn to be observant. I'm afraid they were both a pair of clumsy idiots.
Oh, I'd love Donald Darling to hear you say that. He thinks he's so subtle.
An appalling performance. A man comes into a club bar, he's not a member. No one need bother about him. He inquires about a young girl, also not a member, a casual guest. And instead of saying, we don't know, we don't care, they serve drinks, produce the club book, and fall over themselves to be helpful. Why?
I suppose when you think about it...
It was a performance, Maggie, and it was terrible. Such clumsy liars. Now, let's see what really happened tonight in that bar. As soon as I said who I was, the barman had something to do. He had to press a bell with his foot. The bell rang in Jew's office to tell him I was there. I heard it. Jews needed that signal to telephone you, Miss Frinton. When he'd done that, he came into the bar. He had two things to do. Detain me until you came, and show me the guest book to prove Noreen Wilkes hadn't gone to the party that night.
What's wrong with that?
He didn't need to show me the book. And of course, it wasn't the original page. It was a loose-leaf book. It all been neatly rewritten, one handwriting, one ink.
Yeah, but how does Miss Frinton come into it?
No doubt she'll tell us shortly. I think her job was to act as the beautiful clincher. If I seemed doubtful, it was her turn. Perhaps she'd invite me back here, encourage me to talk. That's her job. And that'd be the end of the Salt nuisance.
I've been a bit stupid about you, Salt.
You're not the only one, are you, dear?
Why did you introduce us so laboriously?
I wanted to see how they'd react. You see, I think your father went there too on Monday. Well, Miss Frinton, you going to bluff it out?
No, Dr. Salt. You win.
But why start churning up everything? Why bother about that silly little bitch?
Noreen, she was my patient and she's missing. And she'll die soon, if she's not dead already. It's a matter of life and death, Miss Frinton. Something quite different from arranging parties and pimping for businessmen.
Oh.
I'm going to find out what happened to this girl if I had to turn Birkden upside down, inside out.
I think you're going too far.
You told me that when you found your father, Culworth. If you want to console Miss Frinton after I've left, that's up to you. But now I want the truth. Where is Noreen Wilkes?
Believe me, Dr. Salt. Please believe me. I don't know. I'll tell you what I do know. Even though I may be looking for a job in a few days. Get me a drink, please.
Whiskey?
Yes, a lot of soda. All right, this is the truth.
There you are.
Oh, thanks. Noreen Wilkes came to that party on the 12th with young Derek Donnington. I didn't want her there. She didn't come to entertain the guests. She was having an affair with Derek. They just wanted to eat, drink, dance for a couple of hours, and then go off to make love somewhere. Don't ask me where they went. I haven't a clue. But I just wished she'd go away and stay away. I was afraid that Sir Arnold would get to know about it and blame me and the club. And another thing, I've never exchanged more than a dozen words with Sir Arnold Donnington. He didn't like the look of me, and I didn't like the look of him. No wonder that poor little Derek was a bit wild and very silly, and that Erica still is.
Donnington has a daughter, then?
Yes, 2 years older than Derek. And a pest. We're lucky she isn't here this minute. She has a lezzy crush on me at the moment.
Yes, yes, yes. Let's get back to Noreen Wilkes and that party.
She and Derek left together. I know that because I saw them go and it was a welcome sight. She may have been sober, but I'm sure he wasn't. Look, if I say any more, I may be tossing my job out of the window.
We can keep anything she says to ourselves, can't we, Dr. Salt?
You can. Probably I can. I imagine she won't be telling us very much.
That's not because I don't want to, Dr. Salt. It's because I really don't know anything. I can only guess. I think he took Noreen Wilkes home, his home, and that his father found them together and there was a terrible row. What happened then is anybody's guess. But I think that as soon as he knew what Derek had done, Sir Arnold got Noreen away somewhere. Well, he had to do that or there'd have been a hell of a scandal. Real sensational Sunday paper stuff, drunken wild parties given by United Anglo-Belgian Fabrics, working girls debauched to entertain foreign buyers.
You think Sir Arnold was terrified of a scandal? A big one that would involve him, his family and his firm?
Yes.
And he took steps at once to make sure there wouldn't be one. Noreen Wilkes had to disappear immediately. No questions had to be asked. The lid was firmly on. And that's where I come in, huh?
I was told last night that a nosy little doctor might be asking questions about Noreen Wilkes.
Sir Arnold told you that?
Sir Arnold wouldn't recognise my existence. No, let's say a third party.
Oh. And did this third party have any more to say?
He said that Dr. Salt was leaving Birkden anyway, perhaps a bit sooner than he thought. So if he did turn up at the club, all we had to do was to persuade him he was wasting his time.
And you fooled him all right, didn't you?
Look, don't you start crowing too soon. All Dr. Salt cares about is knowing what happened to Noreen Wilkes. Soon he may be just as tough with you people.
Who is the third party? Who gave you and Jews your instructions last night?
I can't tell you. I've gone as far as I dare.
In the circumstances, I think that's reasonable.
Oh, you would, Alan, wouldn't you?
Look, Dr. Salt, I can't afford to.
You can't afford not to. I talked to Superintendent Hurst yesterday. I know he does things for Sir Arnold, but within his limits, he's an honest man. He already knows he must make inquiries about Noreen Wilkes. I'll have to tell him she went to that party on September the 12th, but I don't have to tell him how I found out, unless you make me.
All right. You win again. It was Aricson.
Aricson?
Officially, he's public relations at UF. A troubleshooter, a cold, calculating type. I don't know him well. He doesn't often come to the club. You're not going to talk to him?
I am. Tonight, if possible.
Anyone home? Jill, darling. Oh, my God, it's a party. Who are all these people?
This is Dr. Salt.
So you're the Dr. Salt they all keep talking about?
Who keeps talking about me?
My father, for one. Heard him on the phone before I went out last night. Dr. Salting it like mad. I could do with another doctor. I'm tired of boring old Bennett.
I'm sorry, Miss Donnington. It wouldn't be possible. And now, Miss Frinton, if you'll excuse us.
Of course.
I think I might stay on for a few minutes if Jill doesn't mind.
I should like that.
Oh, very well. Come along, Maggie. Good night, Miss Frinton.
See you later, then, Alan.
Then who are you?
Alan Culworth, Erica Donnington.
A solemn square, I'd say. Not bad looking.
Thank you.
Oh, you know me, Jill, darling. I couldn't care less. Can I help myself to a simply enormous gin and tonic?
If you haven't had too many already.
Oh, Jill, darling, they were all so filthy. I followed a girl into that loathsome Buzzy's club. The gin there is really very peculiar. I think old Buzz must make it himself. Now this is quite different.
You're an idiot to go to that place.
I told you why I went. Only she turned out to be awful, a real untouchable. Now, Alan Culworth, I'll tell you something.
Go ahead.
Oh, you must be wondering why Jill's being so rude to me. The reason is I'm in love with her and she's not in love with me.
I see.
Sit down and shut up, Erica.
No. I want to know what you're doing here, Alan Culworth. Trying to make Jill while Tommy Linsdale's away.
No, he isn't.
Oh, don't interrupt, darling. Aren't you attracted to Jill? Most men seem to be. Nothing the matter with you, is there?
Will you please stop this?
Just a man, darling.
Erica!
Oh, never mind. I'm going to the loo.
Well, well, well.
I'm sorry. Look, if you look as if you're staying on, she'll go quite soon. But if you go, God knows when I'll get rid of her. So do stay.
Yes, I'll stay.
Dr. Salt, Miss Culworth, what can I do for you?
Mr. Aricson, where is Noreen Wilkes?
I haven't the slightest idea.
You know who she is?
Oh, yes. I've seen her several times at the Fabrics Club.
Do you know she hasn't been seen or heard of since she attended that party of yours on September the 12th?
Oh, not my party. You mean one of the UF parties at the club? That's the sales director's pigeon, or, since he's away, his PA, Jill Frinton. But I understand that Noreen Wilkes didn't attend that particular party. Have you checked?
I did that earlier.
Well, didn't you find out that she hadn't been there that night?
No, I found she had.
You sure? I rang Jews and he said her name wasn't in the book.
Why did you ring him, Mr. Aricson? You're not responsible for the parties or for Noreen Wilkes.
I just told you I'm not.
Then why suddenly ring up Jews to ask if she was there at a party 3 weeks ago?
Oh, there's no mystery about that, Dr. Salt. It was a Fabrics Club party, and after all, I am in charge of UF public relations. I also happen to be very conscientious, all right?
I'm afraid not, no. On September the 12th, a girl goes or doesn't go to a party. Where do public relations come in?
Now you're forcing my hand, aren't you, Dr. Salt? I don't understand your interest in this, Miss Culworth.
We don't know where my father is either, Mr. Aricson. Dr. Salt thinks he might have called at your Fabrics Club on Monday, just as we did tonight. I mean, to ask about Noreen Wilkes.
Well, I'm sorry, but all this is quite new to me. I know nothing about your father or anybody called Culworth. I do honestly assure you.
Oh, I believe you. But what's in the hand I'm forcing? What have Noreen and that party to do with your public relations?
Okay, Dr. Salt. That party on September 12th was no ordinary club party. And for one very good reason. That was the night young Derek Donnington had an accident cleaning a gun.
Accident?
All right, he shot himself. But don't try saying that in public or you'll run straight into trouble. Now, I work for Sir Arnold and I want to keep my job. The only son he had blew his brains out that night and he's jammed the lid on it. Well, I don't blame him and neither should you.
I'm not blaming anybody, Mr. Aricson. I'm merely asking one question. What became of Noreen Wilkes?
I don't know. And to tell you the truth, I don't care. Whatever arrangements Sir Arnold made, probably for her to clear out immediately, he didn't bring me into it. Now, I admit that's unusual. It's part of my job to attend to things for him, but, well, that's how it was. And I'm ready to swear any sort of oath you want that I know no more than you do about Noreen Wilkes.
All right. I believe you. Do you believe him, Maggie?
I don't want to, but I'm afraid I do.
Quite so. Just another question or two, Mr. Aricson. Now, I don't see Donnington asking our friend Donald Jews to fake his book.
No, Dr. Salt. I didn't.
I thought you did. But why?
I'd had my orders to discourage you.
I know that. But I still ask, why?
Oh, come off it, man. I've explained what happened that night. The boy's suicide was wrapped up and put away. Now, the last thing Sir Arnold wants is somebody like you going to the police and then around the town asking questions. And, of course, I agree with him. No questions, no scandal.
You've missed my point. I know that you and Donnington are afraid of scandal, though I'm neither a reporter nor a policeman. But what is this scandal you're afraid of?
Don't ask me. I've told you all I know.
You mean I should ask Donnington?
Don't be ridiculous. He wouldn't listen to you. He wouldn't even admit his son died from anything but an accident. He'd threaten you with an action for slander.
Maggie, we ought to go.
Right.
Mr. Aricson, thank you for seeing us. I can't pretend to know what you're talking about. You seem to be protecting yourselves against a scandal that isn't there. You mustn't let something out. Although there isn't anything. You're helping Donnington to keep the lid firmly down on nothing. Well, I'll try to accept all that, though it may take some doing. If you'll just ask Donnington one question on my behalf. Just this. Where is Noreen Wilkes? Good night. Tired, Maggie? Oh, it's getting late. I'll get you some tea.
Salt? What made you suspect my father went to the Fabrics Club?
Didn't you see the reaction of the barman and Jews when I so carefully mentioned you, Culworth? The barman went blank on it. Jews, who thinks he's a smart liar, thought he'd be cheeky with it. Really? And ought they to? I mean, is there anything wrong with him? It's all good for a giggle with the barman when we're gone. I believe your father went to the Fabrics Club straight from Peggy Pearson. That explains why these people are all on the alert. I didn't start this yesterday. Your father started on Monday. And then something happened.
To father?
Oh, yes. Oh, nothing so terrible, don't worry.
How do you know?
Well, someone like Jews wouldn't dare to cover it up. It's too risky. But he does know something we don't know. It might make sense if we tried the United Fabrics doctors. Not Dr. Bennett, too old and respectable. The ambitious young Dr. Lemmett. If anything did happen on United Fabrics property... Just let's say I've made it my affair, and I firmly believe it will be in your interest, Dr. Lemmett, to tell me what you know about it.
Very well. He met with an accident, not far from the Fabrics Club, in the grounds of that large old empty house.
Your Worsley place?
Yes, some concussion. I didn't like his heart. And as soon as he was conscious, he was obviously under great emotional strain. Complete rest, sedation, of course.
But no ambulance. I've checked with the ambulance service.
It saved time to make use of one of the company's vans. Well,
saved something, but not time. Where did you take him?
Where he's been having the best possible care.
Well, I didn't think he was tied up in a cellar, but I do want to know where he is.
He's under proper medical care, Dr. Salt. The company have accepted financial responsibility, even though he had no right to be wondering about those grounds. Is my patient, not yours. And I see no reason why I should tell you where he is, especially as he's made considerable progress during the last 2 days. And now, if you'll excuse
me... Just a minute, Lemmett. I won't press you to tell me where he is. I can soon find out, and I will, just as soon as I've cleared up a couple of other things. But when I do find Mr. Culworth, his daughter will be with me. And if there's been any hanky-panky, and I can tell it a mile off, you and your nursing home will be in a hell of a mess.
Now, look,
You didn't send for an ambulance. You haven't tried to notify anybody. You've now refused information demanded on behalf of the patient's family. So, if you give him one unnecessary shot of anything to keep him dopey and quiet, you and your associates are over your heads in trouble. I'll do you this favor, Dr. Lemmett. I'll find him myself, so you can tell Aricson and Donnington it wasn't your fault. But try any funny business from now on, and you'll wish you'd never heard of United Anglo-Belgium Fabrics. Good morning.
I wanted to see you, Dr. Salt. Peggy's written.
Ah, where is she?
Staying with her aunt in Birmingham. She's trying for a job at a picture house.
Okay.
She daren't come back to Birkden because of that tough, the one who told her to keep her big mouth shut and slapped her face. She thinks it's to do with Noreen.
It is. But you can tell her from me that if she wants to come back, she can. Not this week, perhaps, but next. Now, about Noreen. Have you been through her things?
I haven't laid a finger on them, Doctor. Not a finger. Well, I've been expecting her back every day. There's two letters come for her since she left. I put them behind the tea caddy.
Oh, you must give me those letters, Mrs. Pearson. If they're what I think they are and the police got hold of them, some very nice people I know might soon be very unhappy.
Yes, of course, Dr. Salt. Here they are.
Thank you. There's no use keeping them until she comes back. She isn't coming back.
Hello, Dr. Salt.
Oh, Miss Donnington.
Yes. Well, let me in. We can't just stand here. If you want to call it a professional visit, go ahead. I'll pay you whatever we pay silly old Bennett.
No, it's not necessary. Do come in.
Oh, my God! I thought my room was a mess, but this is ridiculous. How can you live like this?
Well, I don't. I'm leaving, so I'm sorting things out.
Well, where do you suggest I sit?
Well, I'll move these books. I'll try that. Why are you here? I'm not available for professional consultation.
Oh, don't be so square. I'm afraid I'm going to be disappointed. Just another dreary doctor. I was curious, after last night. Is there a drink anywhere in all this?
I think so.
Gin and tonic. Plenty of gin, not much tonic. And for God's sake, give yourself one. I hate drinking alone.
So you were curious after last night, Miss Donnington.
Erica, do you mind? Otherwise you'll soon be asking to look at my tongue or my eyeballs, asking me why I don't sleep.
Gin and tonic for one.
Oh, or why I can't hold a bloody glass without shaking so much I spill the stuff all over.
Only for cash down, Erica. Well, what happened last night?
I didn't get a proper look at you. I was half stoned anyhow. I nearly always am now. Not in the morning, at night. You don't look very clever.
Oh, I know.
They got rid of me last night.
Jill Frinton?
And her new boyfriend. I went back later. No lights. His car was still there. Must have been in bed together. I'm crazy about Jill. Oh, men are disgusting. I got into the car and went screaming around the countryside, doing 90 most of the time. Only thing that helps. My life's bloody hell just now.
I'm sorry, but where do I come in?
Your supposed to be so clever. You've scared everybody. My father, Jill. Look, do you have to stare at me like that?
It's doctor's habit. Well, I hardly know your father. I met him for the first time on Tuesday morning at the police station.
I bet you didn't like him.
Well, I might have done if he hadn't so much weight to throw about.
He's so square it hurts. No wonder Derek and I needed to kick things around. He spoiled Derek. And me.
You mean he gave Derek too big an allowance?
Are you being funny? He wouldn't give him anything, especially after they sent him down from Oxford. He never understood him. I kept Derek. I had some money from my mother's estate.
You were very fond of him.
I've told you. I'm not very fond of men. But he depended on me. He couldn't have afforded a double scotch without me. What made you think he had money?
Oh, rumours among the peasantry about taking a girl to the south of France and keeping a flat somewhere around Birkden.
Oh, come on. Believe that and you'll believe anything. He couldn't afford a thing. I don't understand all this about your being clever. Perhaps you're one of those people who aren't very bright in the morning.
Yeah, I think I must be.
I suppose you're after Jill, too. She's mine, you know.
Well, you don't need to worry on that score.
Are you going to give me another drink?
No.
Why not?
Two reasons. First, I'm short of gin and I'm mean. Second, I'm busy. Some other time, please, Erica.
I gather that you've already spoken to Dr. Lemmett.
Yes, Matron, I have. And I've already told him that I'm taking over the case at the request of Mr. Culworth's family. That's true, isn't it, Miss Culworth?
Yes, Dr. Salt.
I'll have a look at Mr. Culworth. If I think he can stand a short journey across town, I shall take him to my place.
Surely, Dr. Salt, all this is, well, very irregular.
It's been irregular from the first, Matron. Dr. Lemmett may possibly have covered himself, but you could soon be in trouble. One wrong move now, and you may find you'll have to turn this nursing home into a boarding house.
But Dr. Lemmett told me, quite distinctly, he would take all responsibility. All responsibility.
Please, Matron.
Oh, I'll take you to Mr. Cutworth's room.
How does he seem?
Oh, very much better. He's told me a great deal, and his mind is easier. He's gone to sleep. He wants to take a rest from reality. Is Alan coming?
About 7 o'clock.
Good.
What's it all about, Salt?
Well, if he ain't got a bird, met it yet, Duck?
And what I've seen bettered, I've seen worse. So if you're looking for anything young and fresh, what about it, Birdie? Dr. Salt will never be any good to you. Too many bloody books.
It's all right, take it easy, Maggie.
You won't be told, will you, Duck? And you can't say I don't warn you. Remember, you're redundant now, so you can be roughed up a bit.
I don't think you'll do anything to me, Russ.
I'm afraid we'll have to. We don't like your attitude. You see, Duck, you wouldn't leave Birkden when you're told. If I were you, honey, I'd tick off.
Oh, Russ, don't I have any playtime?
She isn't going, but you are. For two reasons.
Ah, shove your reasons. Let's shut him up.
Go on, Duck. Two reasons.
Yes, the first is I have an appointment here with Superintendent Hurst at 5 o'clock. And it's a minute or two past five now.
Well, that's your story. Anything else?
Oh, come on, Russ. Let's get stuck into him.
The other reason is this.
Now, what's that, a water pistol? Don't try to scare us with toy guns.
It might look like a water pistol. In point of fact, it's filled with telluric acid.
What's that?
It not only burns the skin, but also stains what's left of it a dark purple.
Go on,
now,
get
him. Now, you two can obviously overpower me. But one of you, the first man, will have a face like a squashed black grape. You have your dark glasses, Russ, some protection. So if anybody's going to risk it, then it ought to be you.
He could be bluffing.
Okay, Russ, have a go and see.
Even with the glasses, Russ, your cheeks, nose, mouth, especially the mouth, will be badly burned.
Who said it'll be dead easy?
I'm afraid he's wrong.
The deal's off, Russ. You stop and play with him, not me.
Come in, Superintendent.
Sorry I'm late, Dr. Salt. Hello. Who are this lot?
Callers.
Invited ones. You look like villains to me.
We're not doing anything, Super. Honest.
Are you charging him, Dr. Salt?
No.
Sure?
Yes.
All right, if you say so. Now, outside, sharp, and don't come back.
Come on, Russ.
You don't want to be soft-hearted with that sort, Dr. Salt.
Superintendent Hurst, Miss Culworth.
How are you doing, miss?
Are you all right, Maggie?
Well, now I am. I must sit down. My knees are like jelly.
I don't want to charge them, Superintendent, simply because I don't want to be kept hanging about as a witness.
No, I see.
Would you have burnt their faces and hands if they'd attacked you?
Not with this, I wouldn't. It's a water pistol. I took it from a small boy at my surgery a week or two ago. Well, Superintendent, I must find a chair for you.
Well, don't bother, Dr. Salt. You wanted to see me, so I looked in, but I'm not staying.
Well, I've been busy since we last met, and everything that's happened points one way. I'm certain now that Noreen Wilkes never left Birkden. that she's dead, and that her death was no accident.
No, Dr. Salt. I told you to leave it to us, didn't I? If you've been busy trying to find out about this Noreen Wilkes, then I'm afraid you've been wasting your time. I'm on my way to Comden Bridge to follow a lead there.
Oh, I wish you'd listen to what I have to say.
I'm trying to save your breath, Doctor, and your face. Will you be here for the next hour or two?
Yes.
Right. Soon as I have the information I need, I'll come back and tell you what happened to Noreen Wilkes. And don't bother, I can let myself out.
Well, have you got to the bottom of it all, Dr. Salt?
Alan, Daddy's here because Dr. Salt found him for us when you and I hadn't a clue. Where do you think you were going to find him? In that Jill thing's bed?
No, Maggie, but I think we might have been allowed to hear Dad's story.
Oh, use your imagination, Alan. He's shaken. He's been knocked out. Filled full of dope. And he has a guilty secret.
All right, then. What is this terrible secret?
Well, it won't seem so terrible to you or to Maggie, but I want you to remember that it is to him. And it would be to your mother, if she ever found out. And you can't afford to take it lightly. It could be entangled in a murder.
Is that a fact, or just your opinion?
My opinion. But just lately, several of my opinions have turned into facts. Now then. During the war, when your father was a sergeant in the RAF, he fell in love and had an affair with a young war widow.
I see.
Now, her name was Catherine Wilkes.
Oh.
Well, I came to know her fairly well because she ended up as a patient of mine. Well, she only died a year ago, cancer. And she had a daughter, Noreen, and from the first, your father chose to regard her as his child.
So that's it, Salt. I think I've really known it all the time. Haven't you, Alan?
No, I've been divided between thinking there was nothing at all in it or that she was his girlfriend.
When your father settled in Hempton after the war, Mrs. Wilkes came to Birkden and got a job at United Fabrics. Why, I don't know if this was his idea or hers. I don't know if the affair continued or whether he simply felt responsible for her and her child. Anyway, he gave her regular allowance.
That's why he was so worried about money.
When she died and Noreen was on her own, he felt even more responsible. Well, he could have just stopped seeing her. He knew by then it was not very likely that he was her father. There had been plenty of other men around Catherine Wilkes. But he worried more than ever. I know that because I've been reading several letters he wrote to her.
Does my father know you've read them?
No, he doesn't, Alan. Well, I don't propose to tell him.
And if you ask me, I think you've been nosy and officious.
Well, I'm sorry you think that. Look, I'm not interested in your father's private life. My concern is what really happened to Noreen Wilkes. I'm sure she's dead. I'm almost sure that she was murdered.
Let's go back to my father. He told you what happened that night?
Yes. Noreen had been missing for 3 weeks. He wrote letters, but they weren't answered. Then Peggy Pearson rang him at the shop to say Noreen had probably gone off to the south of France with her boyfriend. Well, Peggy didn't know who this boyfriend was, but your father did. Your father came back to Birkden, went to the club, and got no sense out of them. So then he decided to search the big empty house, the Worsley place, next to the club. He suspected that was the retreat Noreen and Derek used. It was dark by that time. Before he got to the house, he ran into the night watchman. Your father thinks he was half drunk. Your father tried to push past the man, who cosh'd him.
Then they covered it up.
Yes, well, we can guess the rest. He was taken to the club. Jew sent for Dr. Lemmett, who afterwards spoke to Aricson, who in turn, though I can't prove this, reported to Sir Arnold Donnington. Then your father was rushed off to a private nursing home, and if you want to know why, I'll tell you. This man, your father, wasn't just a casual trespasser. He was somebody who was asking questions about Noreen Wilkes. So, no hospital, no police, no public fuss.
What you're really asking us to believe is that Noreen Wilkes may have been killed, and that somebody high up in United Fabrics may be involved.
That's it exactly.
Oh, well, it seems to me you're jumping wildly to conclusions.
Not as much as you think. I've collected plenty of my own kind of evidence, though so far it wouldn't be worth tuppence as legal proof. If I haven't given it all to you too, that's because I'm waiting to give it to Superintendent Hurst when he comes back.
Do you want us out of the way?
No, I need witnesses. But I propose to keep your father out of it.
Thank goodness.
Well, that's what I say, Mag, so don't go dragging him in yourself. Better just keep quiet.
Well, this must be Hurst. Let him in, Alan.
Well, I think we've settled it, Dr. Salt. We started making inquiries on Tuesday morning. We informed all the police in our area that the girl was missing.
And?
Do you know Comden Bridge?
Well, I know roughly where it is. What about it?
It's where Noreen Wilkes went on the morning of September the 13th. She stayed there a couple of weeks, then left for London. It's just about what I told you she'd do when we were talking on Tuesday morning.
Well, I said you were wrong, and I still think you're wrong.
And I know you're wrong. She did leave Birkden, and she isn't dead. She stayed with a Mrs. Duffy at 86 Gladstone Street, Comden Bridge. And then she went to London. Mrs. Duffy says so. Her daughter says so. And her brother says so. I've been and talked to Sergeant Driver, who interviewed the three of them.
Well, I'm sorry, Superintendent, I don't believe it.
You calling me a liar?
No, of course not. It's those three in Gladstone Street I don't believe. Look, do me a favour, Superintendent. Will you please ring up Compton Bridge and ask Sergeant Driver to take me to call on those three? I'll get in touch with you again immediately afterwards. If I've been wrong, I'll admit it. If not, come round here and listen to me.
Oh, well, I think you're wasting your time, but have it your own way.
Well, Dr. Salt, there's three of them, and they all agree. That's a hard one to beat. A Mrs. Duffy, a daughter named Rose, and a brother, Michael Corrigan.
Corrigan?
That's it.
Works at United Fabrics, a night watchman at the Worsley House.
I believe so.
Did Superintendent Hurst know this?
He knew about Mrs. Duffy, sir. I don't think her brother's name was mentioned.
Oh, he'd be interested. Now, all I ask is that you let me do it my way. However I behave, whatever I say, let it pass without interruptions, eh?
Right then, Doctor. I think we'll find them in. They just bought themselves a new telly.
Oh, for heaven's sake, Sarge. We're trying to enjoy ourselves, just for once.
Switch it off a minute, Corrigan.
Oh, all right.
Mrs. Duffy, Rose, this is Dr. Salt.
Good evening, Doctor.
Oh, I'm very sorry to bother you. Some of these Western serials are very good, aren't they? Take you right out of yourselves, don't they? But you see, Noreen Wilkes was a sick patient of mine, so I must ask you a question or two.
Quite all right, Doctor.
Thank you. She'd been a patient of mine for several years. Even insisted on giving me this photograph of herself.
Oh.
Signing it, too, like a film star. Not so grand, of course. You see, yours gratefully, Noreen. Unusual, but very nice of her, I thought.
Yeah, it's good. It's very good. The spit image, I'd say. The spit image.
No. It's a nice photo, but it doesn't do it justice. Does it, Rose?
Oh, you need colour for Noreen. Mm. You know it was her, of course, but she ought to be in colour. Don't you think so, Uncle Mike?
No, I don't know about that. But it's the spit image.
By the way, Mrs. Duffy, what made Noreen come here?
She wanted to get out of Birkden. And she knows me, because me and her mother worked side by side for years at United Fabrics. If there's anything else you'd like to ask, Doctor, don't hesitate. I know Noreen thought the world of you.
Oh, there is just one thing. She was having some medicine from me I told her she must take without fail night and morning. It was unusual stuff. A dark green colour. Horrible looking. Horrible tasting. But I'd like to think she was taking it regularly.
Like clockwork. She kept it down here, especially so we'd notice if she'd missed a dose. You remember that nasty green stuff, Rose, don't you?
Of course. The faces she pulled.
She said before she left she'd be carrying out Dr. Salt's instructions.
It was Dr. Salt this, Dr. Salt that. Till I felt like telling her to shut up sometimes. When she was here before she went to London, she must have got through a whole bottle of that medicine.
Sergeant, I see no point in going on with this. There never was any such medicine, and the photograph they recognised her once was of a niece of mine who lives in Melbourne. Noreen Wilkes never came here. They never set eyes on her.
But they're all lying.
Of course they are. How do you mean? Lying.
You keep quiet. If they are lying, what's the idea?
Money. I'll bet a down payment on that new telly came out of it.
I'm not being called a liar.
Coming here and soft-soaping us.
Corrigan, just listen to me. You're in a hell of a mess. I'm looking after the man you coshed on Monday night outside the Worsley place. He happens to have a thin skull and a bad heart. He might live. He might die.
Well, how did I know he'd go out like that?
You idiot! Now you've done it!
What is all this?
Oh, honest to God, Sarge.
I can't waste any more time. Come on, Sergeant. I've got to get back to Birkden. Superintendent Hurst had better hear my story now.
All right, Doctor. I'll play fair. I'm ready to listen. We were taken in. But how did you get onto Corrigan in the first place?
On Tuesday, when you and I were talking in your office, Sir Arnold Donnington had asked you to have an eye kept on the Worsley place because his man Corrigan had been taken off the job.
That's right.
Well, in fact, Corrigan was in trouble, and he'd been told to clear out. That's when he went to his sister in Compton Bridge, and a day or two later he was bribed to come up with this nonsense.
Who bribed him?
Aricson, I guess, acting on behalf of Sir Arnold.
Oh, now, wait a minute.
Look, if you interrupt me every time the sacred name of Sir Arnold is mentioned, we'll get nowhere. On Tuesday morning, when I was listening to Sir Arnold, I asked myself two questions. First, why was he worrying about the old Worsley place, which is going to be a sort of annex to the club, when he's not interested in the club at all?
Well, his firm had bought the place.
Next question I asked myself was why this important man, talking about an unimportant matter, was obviously in a state of great tension.
Well, he seemed all right to me. A bit high and mighty as usual, that's all.
Well, he has high blood pressure, I imagine, and he suffers from hypertension. He was doing his damnedest to appear casual, but his eyes and hands were all wrong. So I asked myself, why was he feeling so excited? And I came up with two answers. First, he was making himself talk about the Worsley place. Second, He was talking about it in front of me.
Now, Doctor, Sir Arnold hardly knew you from Adam.
Oh, yes, he did. You're forgetting that you just introduced me as a doctor making inquiries about a patient called Noreen Wilkes.
Yeah.
When he insisted on telling you he hadn't been near the Worsley place for months, I sensed he'd not only been near it, but inside it quite recently.
But why should he lie about it?
Noreen and Derek Donnington weren't just messing about. I read some of his letters to her. They were in love, and busy making love, as you can imagine.
I couldn't at one time. There's nothing in that line I can't imagine now. Straight to bed these days.
And they had to have somewhere to go.
And you think it was the Worsley house?
Exactly. Now, Noreen was never seen again after she left that party with Derek on the night of September the 12th. All we know for certain is that Derek, who was in love with her, went home and killed himself early next morning. Why? Nobody knows. Perhaps he knew Noreen was dead.
Oh, pure guess.
If so, it's not unreasonable to assume that she met her death that night in the old Worsley place.
How?
Well, it's her illness, but it's highly unlikely that she died a natural death. She might have lost her life as a result of some accident, but I can't help believing she was killed. Murdered.
Ah, you've no real evidence. It's just a tall story to me.
But all the facts surrounding it would seem a tall story if I didn't know they were facts. Ever since I started asking questions about this girl, I've been elaborately lied to, threatened, told to shut up and go away. I went to see Aricson, Sir Arnold's dog's body at United Fabrics. He as good as admitted he was trying to shut me up. Not because he knew anything about Noreen, but because Sir Arnold was afraid of a scandal in which his son would be involved.
I can understand that, can't you?
No, I can't. You're seeing it like Aricson. You're accepting the scandal excuse because you refuse to take a long, close look at it. If Noreen simply cleared out that night, there's no scandal. If she didn't, then there's something terribly wrong that has to be uncovered.
No, Dr. Salt, that doesn't follow. For instance, suppose Sir Arnold discovers that night the girl was pregnant and made arrangements for her to go away.
I was her doctor, superintendent, in her confidence. I'd seen her that morning. Pregnancy's out. But what stays in is Donnington's peculiar state of tension on Tuesday morning and all his attempts to confuse or block my inquiry.
An inquiry entirely in a private capacity. I doubt if you could bring a single charge.
I don't want to bring charges. I'm a doctor, not a policeman. Noreen Wilkes was in my care. I want to know exactly what happened to her. And now I'll make a lot more out of nothing for you, Superintendent. I say that Noreen died in that house and that Sir Arnold Donnington knows all about it.
Wait a minute.
If I wait much longer, I'll be run out of Birkden before I can prove anything. I'm sure she was murdered.
You'll have to show me a body before I believe that.
Well, I'm going to have a look.
Our man up there won't let you near the house on your own. Besides, this is police work.
So?
I'm coming with you. I think it's all moonshine, but there's no harm in taking a look. If you can't convince me, perhaps I can convince you.
Well, Dr. Salt, that's about it.
Ooh, I'll be glad to get out of here, sir.
Smells awful, doesn't it, Pickles?
Just a minute. There's this room with the door locked. I'm going to have a look. Well, it's not a heavy door. Two of us could charge our way in.
That's property damage.
Oh, come on, man. If there's anything, it'll be inside this room. Look, if there's no sign here, I'll admit I've been wasting your time and I won't waste any more of it.
All right.
It's a strong lock.
Never mind, I've done this sort of job before. No need to bruise our shoulders. There's a neck in it. Keep your torch shining on the lock, Dr. Salt. I think a good-sized 12 fuel will do it. Right!
That's good, sir.
Now, what have we got here? A bed of sorts, a couple of old blankets, chair, a bit of mirror on it. Face powder's been spilt. Smells funny what it does nowadays. Well, you're right up to a point. There's your love nest.
What about these trunks piled against the wall?
I think there's a body in one of them, Doctor. All right. Leave it to Pickles and me. Take that top trunk down, Pickles, and open the other two. You can shine your torch, Doctor. It's all the help we need from you.
Nothing in here, sir. Only newspapers and bits of rubbish.
No sign of another trunk murder, eh, Doctor? Might as well put them back, Pickles.
Just a minute. Look at these two odd lengths of wallpaper.
The same as what's already on the wall,
sir.
Could
you shine your torches where I've got mine? Thanks.
What is it?
This piece of wallpaper looks new to me.
Might be, yes.
And somebody's cleaned the floor thoroughly before pulling that trunk over it.
It's a possibility.
There's only a thin board here. It could be cardboard. Either of you got a good strong knife?
You are, sir.
Thanks.
Yes. Can't mistake that smell. It's a corpse, all right. What's left of it. All right, Pickles, get to the nearest phone, sharp as you can. Tell Sergeant Broadbent that we found a body here.
Yes, sir.
Now then, This is for the police doctor now, and I can't stop you having a look. Is it Noreen Wilkes?
No. It's a lump of putrefying meat. But when it wasn't, it belonged to Noreen Wilkes. Your man will give you all the details, but I can tell you this. It was a nasty kind of murder. Lots of hate in it. Madness, perhaps.
Well, I admit it. You were clever working it out. Seems pretty clear now, doesn't it?
What's clear, Superintendent?
Oh, it was Derek Donnington. He brought her here, then they had a quarrel. He did her in, put the body where we found it, went home and shot himself.
That's a queer program, that, isn't it? Why spend 2 or 3 hours hiding a body, even repapering a wall in the middle of the night, if you're going home to shoot yourself?
Oh, he was going to brazen it out, then changed his mind. They often do.
Well, I have several other questions harder to answer than that one.
And if you've any sense, Dr. Salt, you'll keep them to yourself. You wanted to know what happened to your patient. Now you've found out. I'll admit it was a brilliant piece of work. A lot of guessing of a sort we're not encouraged to indulge in, but very clever. But now, just go away and forget it.
Tell me why, Superintendent.
Right, I will. In strictest confidence, whatever you may read in the papers, this case is closed here and now. Oh. There's no doubt in my mind that young Donnington killed her, then killed himself. But I can't say so, because at his inquest we went for a verdict of accidental death. Well, this one will be person or persons unknown. Can't do it any other way. And as I know who the murderer was, the case is closed.
So, Derek Donnington killed her, and that's why he shot himself.
Well, that's the story. The only trouble is I don't believe it.
Oh, Salt, leave it alone. Derek Donnington and Noreen are dead. They can't run into any more trouble. You're alive, and you can. Oh, there's a kind of conceited pig-headedness in you, and I don't like it.
That sleeping dogs lie, is that it?
If you like.
No, Maggie. I want to go with an easy mind and a clear conscience.
You'll get no help from the police.
My dear Miss Culworth, believe it or not, I need only one other piece of information and the mystery is solved. Now, you go and talk to your father. He's up and dressed and seems much more himself.
Who on earth's that?
Buzzy. Come in.
Hello, then. Wanted to have a chat. Thought I'd drop round in the new rolls. Give the natives a thrill.
New rolls, eh?
Yeah, I'm more than halfway to Buckhouse with a car like that.
Where did you get it, Buzzy?
From a punter at the betting shop. Instead of the money he owed me. Talk about a bargain. I reckon he's more than 2,000 knicker down on this lot. And guess what? I've got Whitey pretending to be Shover.
I could use that car, Buzzy.
Well, right. Help yourself.
Maggie, you and your father can go back to Hempton with Whitey while Buzzy's talking to me. Everything's ready at home, isn't it?
Yes, but I mean...
Remember that as far as your mother's concerned, it's loss of memory. There are to be no questions.
I'll remember.
Well, go on. Go and help him.
Salt.
Please.
Oh, all right.
Nice little wench, that.
Yes. Well, sit in that chair, Buzzy.
Thank you.
That's the only one that'll hold you. Now then, what is it?
Well, I've had a bit of info, and it looks like things are hotting up for you. You see, if it wasn't Friday, I'd get a couple of my boys to look after you here. But Friday and Saturday can be a flaming great dogfight down at the club, and I need more hard boys than I've got. So what do we do with you, Doc?
Oh, I'm not worried, Buzzy.
I never said you were. I am. So I want you to do me a favour, if you see what I mean.
Well, what's that, Buzzy?
Well, I want you to take a load off my mind. Now, I'm not going to spend tonight watching all those baboons and the scrawny little birds at my club and wondering what the hell's happening to you here. I want me mind on me business. So do me a favour. Stay away from here tonight and tomorrow, see?
I'm not leaving Birkden.
I know you're not. This is where I do you a favour. I've booked you into this posh new hotel, the Bavalier Astoria. Only opened this week.
I'm not going.
Now, look. If you're down there, nobody will be trying to kick your teeth in, right? That sort of thing doesn't happen among the top people. And you're in a suite, not just a bedroom. A suite on the 10th floor.
I can't afford it. Neither can you.
Me? I could afford to take the whole bloody floor if I wanted to.
All right, Buzzy. It's very kind of you to have taken so much trouble. Though I doubt if it's my kind of hotel.
What can I get you, sir?
A dry martini, please. Make it dry.
Room comfortable, sir?
Yes, thank you.
Salt, there you are.
Oh, Maggie, how'd you get here?
I was worried about you. Buzzy told me where to find you.
Trendsetter's paradise. Is your father all right?
Yes. And Mother's not questioning him or reproaching him.
Good.
look who's here.
Where?
There, with a man.
Excuse me a moment, Maggie.
Oh, darling, get me another drink, will you?
Yes, all right, darling.
Miss Donnington, isn't it? I thought I recognised your voice. Dr. Salt, remember?
Oh, yes.
Have we met? I seem to know your face.
No, I don't think so. I can't imagine why we should have done. My name's Walsh.
He's really telling you to go away, aren't you, darling?
Yes.
Of course. I'm intruding. Excuse me.
Yes, sir?
You've Mr. Walsham staying here. What's his room number? He's a friend, and I'm staying here myself, room 1012.
Mr. Walsham's in 806. Shall I tell him you inquired?
No. Let me surprise him.
His coffee's good. Almost as good as you get in France.
Yes, certainly a lot better than the rest of the meal.
You'll be there in a few days.
In France?
Well, that's where you said you were going. The Dordogne.
Only briefly. There's a man I want to see in Barcelona and another in Zurich. They specialise in certain kidney diseases. I want to see what they're doing.
Oh, it's not my idea of a holiday. The Dordogne, marvellous, but why let the kidneys take over?
Well, given the right time and place, I could keep you enthralled by my story of the kidney, its disasters and triumphs, its hopes and fears. But not here, not now. What's the time?
Just after 11.
So, we go to work.
Oh, Salt.
Now listen, this is what I want you to do.
For God's sake, what is it?
I'm so sorry.
Wrong room.
Well, that's the point. I'm in 906, you see, and I think a parcel of mine may have been delivered here by mistake.
No parcel here.
Are you sure?
Of course I am.
I ought to have managed it better, but he wasn't prepared to be interested in female callers. I thought I heard a laugh, but I certainly can't prove he had a girl in there. Sorry, Salt.
Not to worry.
I'll try something else.
What in hell do you want? Can't we get any bloody peace?
That's all. I can run you home now, Maggie.
Do you mean you've finished now?
For tonight. I don't want you to go, but I think it might be wise. Because I now believe I know who killed Noreen. And why. Is she still down there, Buzzy?
Yes, but not on the floor, though. My boys have got her taped.
They've switched the coloured lights on. Very pretty.
Oh, we got everything here.
Mr. Duffy?
And who are you?
Why, it's our Mr. Aricson.
Now, look, just a minute. I mean, this isn't a reception. This is my private office.
Look, if you want me to apologise, Mr. Duffield, I apologise. Sir Arnold Donnington asked me to find his daughter, Erica, and take her home. I've been inquiring all over Birkden. Now I understand she's here.
Oh, she's here, all right. Saturday night with the riff-raff. Half stone, too. A flaming pest, your Miss Erica is. If I bar her, I'll run into trouble. If I let her carry on like this, I'll run into trouble. Hey, I can't win with this lot.
But she's down here somewhere, huh?
In the ladies, I'm told. Close to passing out.
Buzzy, I think I better take a look at that girl, and fast. Who's that? Dr. Harrison. Look, this is Dr. Salt. I'm at Buzzy's club, and there's a girl here who's been mixing barbiturates and alcohol. Erica Donnington. Yes, coma, of course, but not deep yet. Yes, we've got the ambulance coming. I'll bring her in. No, we'll tell her father. Now, Maggie, my dear, here's my key. Go back to the flat and wait for me.
Right.
Mind who you let in. Where's Aricson?
I'm here.
Well, I want you to go and collect Sir Arnold. Tell him what's happened and where his daughter will be. General Hospital. Ask for Dr. Harrison. And I want you to drop off Miss Culworth at my flat. It's on your way.
Right. You ready, Miss Culworth?
That's not all. Tell Sir Arnold this. It's serious. But I think we've caught her in time. Now, as soon as she's out of danger, I expect to see him at my flat, whatever the time. Tell him I have too much evidence now to let this go any further.
Oh, I doubt if he...
Aricson, I have to see him tonight. This is where we all stop playing games.
Dr. Salt, I'm not staying long. I've had an anxious time and I'm an elderly man. I came here only because I owe you something. Dr. Harrison said my daughter could have lost her life if you hadn't been so prompt. Nothing was said about all your friends being here.
Not all. There are a few others elsewhere. But let me introduce Miss Frinton, Miss Culworth, and Dr. Culworth. Miss Frinton's one of your employees. Culworth is the name of the man your caretaker knocked out on Monday night. So you might say they're all in the picture.
Well, Dr. Salt, I can only give you a few minutes. What do you want?
I want you to drop that tone, Sir Arnold. Come down a few pegs.
I'm afraid that doesn't mean anything to me, Dr. Salt.
I see. You're staying on that lofty height, are you?
Well, you'll have to come down from it sooner or later, and staying up there only increases the tension. Well, look at your hands, man. Well, that's right. Put them away in your pockets. But something else gives you away, something you can't control. A visible pulse. I noticed it when I saw you in Superintendent Hurst's office the other morning. High tension. I knew then that Noreen Wilkes was important to you.
Rubbish. I never knew the girl. And if that's all you have to
You're running your own lie detector, you know, Sir Arnold. Every time you speak, your blood contradicts you. You'll have to do something about that blood pressure.
I have quite a competent doctor. He's never suggested a second opinion, and if he did, it wouldn't be yours, Dr. Salt.
Well, hypertension has never been one of my special studies. Though I worry about how far it might affect the eyesight of an elderly man.
What do you mean?
You had to be very careful that night, September the 12th, when Noreen Wilkes was murdered. I think you were careful, but your eyesight was at fault. You see, there were two bits of evidence up in that attic room you overlooked. I have them. At least, I had them. But now they're in a little packet I sent to a colleague of mine, together with an account of what I really think happened that night. He's not in Birkden, by the way, so you can't get at him. And if he doesn't hear from me during the next 24 hours, I've asked him to open the packet and contact Scotland Yard.
I don't know what you're talking about.
About the possible effect on eyesight of a state of hypertension. Take another example. I'm sure you tried to be very careful matching that wallpaper exactly. Yet I saw at once that it didn't match.
That's a lie. It matched exactly.
Now you've done it, haven't you?
So you were in that room, covering the cavity in the wall where the body was hidden. And don't tell me now you were doing it for your son. I'd be too ashamed to listen.
Don't imagine you're making any sense, Dr. Salt.
Oh, drop it, man. Your son didn't kill that girl. He was in love with her. And he was your son. And now he's dead. Do we have to pretend that he was a homicidal sex maniac to keep you safe?
Very well. I killed her.
So you killed her, did you? Why?
I'll sit down, if you don't mind.
Yeah. Here you are.
Thank you. I'd heard rumors of this affair. I was told they were using the old Worsley place. I went there that night and found them. I was deeply shocked, then very angry. I ordered Derek to get dressed and clear out. I made him leave me with a girl. Then I appealed to her to let him go, offered her money to go away. She not only refused, but she taunted me, saying she was going to marry him. He was an evil little slut, lying there half-dressed, jeering at me. And then something snapped. I can't tell you exactly what happened, because I can't remember. Then I found myself staring at the body. What happened afterwards, you seem to know, although I can't imagine what possible evidence you can have found.
And your son?
By the time I'd done everything I could to hide what had happened, it was very late, nearly morning. Derek had been drinking. I tried to make him believe the girl had agreed to go away, but something in my manner made him suspicious. Finally, he forced it out of me. He rushed out of the room. Before I could find him or stop him, he shot himself. Now you know the truth, all of you.
And I believe you.
And so do I.
No, we're miles from the truth yet. Let's have a drink. Sir Arnold, some whiskey?
Thank you. I need a drink.
A stiff one? Neat, perhaps?
You really are the most extraordinary man, Dr. Salt. You begin talking about drinks just when I think you'll call for the police.
I have nothing to do with the police. I'm a doctor, not a detective.
Yes, but...
If the police don't come into it, what's the point of all this?
I'll tell you two points. First, the discovery of the truth. What did happen to Noreen Wilkes? The second point is, having discovered the truth, to decide the best thing to do.
What about those bits of evidence you said you'd sent to a colleague? If you were bluffing, Dr. Salt, you'd never prove a thing, you know. I'll just keep on saying I did it.
But you did, didn't you?
Of course he didn't.
Then who did?
It was you, Sir Arnold, who hid the body after your son came home and told you what had happened. But it was Erica who did the strangling and mutilating.
Huh?
But why?
She was insane with jealousy. She and her brother were very close. There might have been an incestuous relationship, and it was probably to cover this that she pretended to be a lesbian. Oh, it was just talk. Late last night, she was with a man in a room at the Beverly Astoria.
Room 806.
Well, she must have followed her brother that night, somehow got rid of him, probably told him you were looking for him, and then started a violent quarrel with Noreen.
She blacked out, Salt. She never knew she'd done it. She thought she'd dreamt it. When Derek realized what had happened, he shot himself. What was I to do?
What you did was wrong, even for Erica. Well, how can you be sure she won't black out again?
I know, Salt. What are you going to do now?
I'll get you off the hook. No police, no trials, no scandals. Now I know the truth, I'll take the risk of burying it. But you'll have to submit to two conditions.
What are they?
First, Erica. She's just as sick as if she'd had typhoid. But if she can be cured, and I think she can, I can send you to the man who might do it. Take her to him as soon as she's ready to leave hospital. Stay by her. See her as often as you can. And that brings me to the second condition.
What is it?
Everywhere I've gone this week, I've been told that without you, Birkden would fall to pieces. That's not true. But there's been far too much Sir Arnold Donnington in Birkden.
Every time I've turned a corner, I've run into something you owned or controlled. It's bad for Birkden, it's bad for you. You'll have to get out.
I can't accept that, of course. You're taking too much on yourself, Salt.
If you can't let Birkden go, I'll bring it down on top of you. Don't forget, four of us know what happened. If you still want to be Mr. Big, then you're going to be Mr. Big who hit a body and said nothing about a murder. Maggie, get the police.
No. No, stop. If I have to stay near my daughter, then I can start easing out. You'll get your way, Salt. I'm assuming, of course, that you'll all keep quiet.
I can promise you that.
Then I'll say good night.
I finished my whiskey.
Yes, but you can have mine. I don't want it.
You know, Dr. Salt, there have been times this week when I thought you were just fooling around. Now I know how wrong I was. By the way, what was that evidence you had against Donnington and his daughter?
I hadn't any. Hall bluff. And knowing something about people.
I see.
Come on, Alan, time for us to go.
Maggie, can we give you a lift?
Don't be so insensitive. Come on.
Maggie, how would you like a holiday?
I wish you'd explain to me how you worked everything out.
I'll do that, Maggie, my love, one night after a good dinner, somewhere in the Dordogne. And we'll sit down over a cognac, and I'll tell you.
In Salt is Leaving by J.B. Priestley, Dr. Salt was played by Frederick Treves, and Maggie Culworth by Patricia Gallimore. Buzzy Duffield, Ralph Lawton, Superintendent Hurst, Jack Holloway, Jill Frinton, Maggie McCarthy, Sir Arnold Donnington, William Fox, Erica Donnington, Elizabeth Revill. Other parts were played by Eileen Barry, Liz Daniels, George Woolley, Lawrence Rue, Joyce Latham, and Harvey Edwards. The play was dramatised for radio by Elizabeth Bradbury and produced in Birmingham by Roger Pine. 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 By Roger Pine.